And it is a great pleasure to welcome Lida Shtepankova, who is the chairman of the Society of the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra to this session. Well, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to you all. It is a great pleasure to have you here, and a particularly warm welcome to our distinguished guest this evening, my very fine friend, the distinguished pianist Béla Hartmann. Hello, Béla. A very warm welcome to you. It is so good to see you. I hope that you're well. A lot of us have been waiting with some impatience for this session, to which we have looked forward very greatly. Ladies and gentlemen, given that this session is being recorded with a view to being placed on YouTube, for the benefit of people who are not yet familiar with Béla and his work, I should like to say a very brief introductory word, and I'll now share my screen, if I may. And hope that it is now visible. Are you able to see my screen, ladies and gentlemen?
Yes, no problem.
Splendid, thank you. Well, this is an evening of words and music with Béla Hartmann, a prize-winning pianist of both national and international competitions, a pianist based in the UK of Czech and German extraction, and someone who has established a strong reputation for lively and individual interpretations of a very wide repertoire, ranging from Jean-Philippe Rameau to Sir Harrison Birtwistle, but with Schubert, Mozart, and Beethoven forming the core of this extensive range. He has been a prize winner at various competitions, of which perhaps the most interesting, given that I'm hoping that we shall be able to talk quite a lot about Schubert this evening. So Béla was a prize winner in the International Schubert Competition in Dortmund in 1997, a winner of the Beethoven Medal of the Beethoven Piano Society of Europe in 1995. He was a semi-finalist at the Leeds International Piano Competition, and rather remarkably, in 2005, Béla performed the complete piano sonatas and dances by Schubert in a series of 8 recitals at Steinway Hall, London. But then he took those to a variety of venues, and other exciting programs that he has performed include the complete press book of Bach's Well-Tempered Clavier, and his repertoire, of course, includes a fair share of works by Dvorak and Smetana. I've already mentioned Birtwistle, but his repertoire also includes such 20th century masters as Luciano Berio and the Czech late composer Petr Eben. Interestingly, he has also experience of performing extensively on fortepianos, and he has given recitals at all sorts of prestigious venues in London, all over the British Isles and Europe, and in the US, where he appeared at the Carnegie Recital Hall in New York. He has performed concertos by Brahms, Prokofiev, Dvorak, Beethoven, and Mozart. Out of the many interesting things that he's done, I should like to mention Stravinsky's Lenos in Cyprus, the island of my birth, of all places. But in addition to his very fine performer's career, Béla is also a very keen musical essayist, and he has published articles both in print as well as online on such areas as performance practice and artistic identity. Now, he has been associated with Prague partly for family reasons, not just musical reasons, But also, I'm very, very happy indeed to say that there is a musical friendship between Béla and the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra. We have been privileged in that he has performed the Beethoven Choral Fantasia with us on several occasions. Our most recent collaboration was with the world premiere at the Czech Museum of Music of Milan Iglo's piano concerto that some of you may remember having taken part yourselves. And we are very much hoping that in the future he may be able to play one or other or both of the Brahms piano concertos with us, and perhaps more imminently the Bach D minor concerto. So that is something of an introduction that I wanted to make. But to me, most important of all, he's one of my finest and closest personal friends, and I'm very glad that whenever the Hartmann family, that Bella, his wife Julia, and their daughter Eliska happen to be in the Czech Republic, they very kindly find the time to give me a ring, and usually we manage to meet up, perhaps for a meal at the musical discussion. This is the father and daughter pair at the Dobra Chajovna, I think, Wenceslas Square. And this is Stromovka, if I'm not mistaken. And this is the one photograph I was able to find in the aftermath of the world premiere of the Milan Iglo Concerto for Piano and Orchestra, of which we were honored to give the premiere together. And this must have been, I suppose, getting on for 10 years ago now, or maybe 8 years, something like that.
I think so, yes, quite a while.
Quite a while. But this will be just one element of our conversation. Rather, what I would very much like is for everyone to imagine that Béla and I and all our listeners are at a very pleasant and cozy Czech hospoda or pub or restaurant where we're able to relax and exchange some thoughts about music, about performance, about education, and perhaps some musical memories, plans, as well as enjoy some specimens of Béla's interpretations of various musical pieces, things that are close to him. Just to give you a quick indication, these are some of the essays that have been published, written by Béla, and you can find them on his website if you want to look at them at your leisure. But I should like now to stop sharing my screen for a while and allow Béla himself to take over. How are you?
Very well, and very happy to be here. Haig, thank you so much for inviting me. And thank you to everyone who's listening, who's joined in, and particularly to those members of the orchestra. Haig says that we've had a few nice occasions together. I have such fond memories of our collaborations. It's such a pleasure to perform together with your orchestra, and well, I consider myself very privileged to have that opportunity. So, as Haig says, it would be nice to do that again in the future. I look forward to it, but already I have wonderful memories of it.
You are extremely kind. That feeling is very much mutual, and I speak not only on my own behalf, which I do, of course, but I believe also on behalf of our orchestra and chorus.
Thank you. We were speaking the other day, weren't we, Haig, about what possible topics would be of interest to discuss this evening. And apart from the particular interest in Schubert, then I was kind of making some notes, and it seemed to me that for a long time, my deliberations in terms of music always revolve around the question of what am I looking for when I listen to someone perform something, and when I play myself, what are the motivations? What am I trying to achieve, or what am I hoping to hear when I enjoy a performance? And it's again and again, it comes back to the question of this authenticity, this kind of musical truth. And I think the word authenticity has been used in many different ways. But for me, authenticity is something like the truth that I think Kafka spoke about nicely when he wrote somewhere, there is only one truth, but it has a very lively and changing face. And I find that is one very true of music. It's possible to say that something doesn't have any truth in it, but it's not possible to say what the truth is. And there are so many possibilities, but you recognize it, don't you? When you hear something, when you hear a performance, then you sort of feel this is just right. It makes sense. This is the music speaking to me directly. And that's something which obviously I try in my own playing, although it's quite a difficult thing to try, because in a way it has to come naturally, but one must make the circumstances to allow that to happen.
Yes.
But I don't know if you have any reflections on that, any thoughts, as far as your conducting is concerned.
Well, I think modesty would preclude my saying it in connection with my own conducting, but I have been extremely lucky in my youth to have been present at performances of works that had until then remained incomprehensible to me, and therefore not enjoyable. And they have been interpreted in my presence in such a way that one has suddenly felt intelligent. And I say intelligent, but it's not even something that I think happens at intellectual level, but everything somehow falls into place naturally, and it has a tremendous effect on one, and the music works for one.
Yes.
Everything has clarity, everything has, I hesitate to say logic, because it's not really entirely to do with something that you could explain away rationally with any ease, but it feels right. And then you say, ah, I understand, yes, and this is a masterpiece, I love this music. And what is the purpose of music? Well, as Debussy said, music seeks humbly to please, so it must give one pleasure. But what does the pleasure accrue from? There is an element of catharsis. There is an element of one's being taken through a cycle. There's an element of tensions being built up in a particular way, and then those tensions being resolved in a way that is meaningful and satisfying and pleasing. And I've had this sort of experience with, say, Brahms symphonies, with the late Maestro Giulini and the Philharmonia Orchestra in the very late 1980s and early 90s, the Brahms symphonies, I came late to them. I listened to recordings. I just couldn't bring myself to like them.
Yes.
And then suddenly you attend some concerts where it is done in a way that works for you. And I remember Giulini would repeat his concert on two successive nights in London, and I'd go both times. The first time I'd say, well, I'll just allow the music to wash over me. I won't try to analyze or understand or explain what he's doing and why it is working. Whereas when I listen to Karajan's recordings, it didn't work for me. I'll do that the second night, and I'll sit on the train, go to London for the second night, and I'd try and see what he's doing, why it is working. But after about 5 minutes, I'd give up and I'd say, Haig, don't be a fool. Stop analyzing. Just count yourself lucky that you're there and allow the music to work. But it does open doors for one. And it did lead to my feeling some years later able to interpret those works myself. And I've so far performed 3 out of the Brahms symphonies. I've not done number 3 because I feel that I'm still too young and too young, despite my chronologically past. But I know exactly the sort of experiences that you're talking about. And of course, if in one's very small way, one is able to perform the music in a way that makes it clear and coherent and effective to others, then that is what one's duty is, not just towards the public, but towards the composer. We try to make the music work. But of course, all this that I've said is, as you can point out, very, very wishy-washy and very, very imprecise. I don't think it's inaccurate, but it's imprecise. I've couched what I've said in terms that I'm sure you feel similarly, but a third person could say, but what do you mean that the music worked? What exactly does that mean? And then we would have to go down to the nuts and bolts and say, well, in certain instances, if you allow the music to breathe, if you delay something, if you stay a little longer, if you shape the phrase in a certain way, if you do certain things more legato, then it becomes more meaningful because one has to sympathize with what the music is trying to do and allow the ebb and flow to take effect in a way that reinforces these things. And you have to allow it to breathe, you have to give it more time, you have to balance it, you have to phrase it. After all, individual notes in themselves, it seems to me, do not have meaning. But the way one note is connected, or one chord is connected to what came before and what is coming afterward, is what helps create and in due course resolve those tensions. But this is just...
Yes, I'm reminded of two things. The first thing is, I'm a great admirer of the British painter Francis Bacon. And not just of his paintings, but also of his writings or his interviews, his thinking. He reflected very, very interestingly, I think, on all kinds of artistic matters in a way that is very relevant to music. And I find that he spoke about this. He was saying that he will start his painting with a gesture, like maybe throw some paint on the canvas or just make some sort of wild line, something. And he was very keen on chance, on that spontaneous action. And he said that you have to lose yourself, you have to lose your control, you have to try to evade that and give something immediate of yourself. And then the interviewer asked him, yeah, so you're interested in chance, where does the skill come? And he said, well, you have to work very hard. Well, he used different words. You have to work very hard in order to be able to use chance and spontaneity. And I think it's this balance or contradiction between the detail, the art of the craft of making the music, of understanding the connections of blending sounds, of building up momentum and tension, that with this simple truth that can follow through these things, that you allow them to happen. And I remember also my one of my teachers, John Bingham, he was very keen, well, he recommended this book to me called Zen and the Art of Archery. And he found it very relevant to music. And I read it at the time, and there was a wonderful passage where some simple person was asking a Zen master, how should I release the arrow to hit the bullseye in the target? And the master said, it's very easy. You have to stop trying. And the pupil said, it's not possible. It's very, very hard. I can barely draw the bow. There's no way that I can hit that. It's a very, very hard work. And the master says, no, it's very, very easy. And I think this encapsulates this problem. It is very, very easy, but it is also extremely hard. And one has to navigate this somehow, doesn't one? But all I know is that the moments where it happens, where you feel that something has worked, it's really, something has happened during your own performance, is not something that you can plan. It's something that you can work a lot, but then it just happens or it doesn't happen. And you have very little control over that, or no control. But it's a wonderful feeling when it does happen, isn't it? I mean, that moment.
Absolutely. And of course, what you said about spontaneity applies even more so when one is not performing alone, but one is standing in front of a group of talented musicians. Mm. And one must know where to be prescriptive so that things are together and there are certain parameters. But the very best results seem to accrue when you give freedom, when they already know what you want and you already know what they feel and you feel the same more or less, but they give you things that are perhaps even better or even finer and a little different from what you expected. And that inspires you and helps you inspire them.
Yes.
There was an incident. I remember it was the second occasion when I conducted Beethoven's Eroica Symphony. It was at the music faculty's West Road Concert Hall in Cambridge. And we had a program. We started with a Webern Passacaglia, having done the previous concert, which ended with Brahms 4. So we finished the previous concert with the Passacaglia and started the next one with the Passacaglia. Then there was, I think, the Divertimento, the suite from Le Baiser de la Fée by Stravinsky, an interval, and Beethoven's Eroica. And in the last moment of the Eroica, towards the last section, pom, bim, pom, pom, bim, pom, pom, bim, something happened. Either I was unhelpful with my upbeat, with my gesture, or the horns misinterpreted what I'd shown. It ended up being substantially slower than I intended. So it was different from what I'd planned, different from what I'd rehearsed. But what can you do? The best you can do is just to allow things to take your course, and no one quite knows how it's going to be.
Yeah.
And it was much better than anything that I had rehearsed or imagined. It sort of expanded to fill the space available, and it flowed, and the horns really blossomed. It was one of those rare goose pimple occasions, although one has to remember that when one is performing, certainly when one is conducting, but also I think when one is playing, the intention is not to give oneself moments of goose pimple, rather to give members of the audience to have those goose pimples. But yes, one has to relinquish control. One needs experience and some judgment to know when one can best afford to relinquish control. Yes, you get the best results when things are allowed in the best possible sense to acquire a life of their own, an existence of their own. Otherwise, it all sounds calculated, and there are few things you can do as effective in killing the music as just doing everything as an aggregate of a series of calculated decisions, and I don't think that we're in the business of doing that. Although, all too often, one finds that when one goes to concerts these days, one is confronted with performances with which there is nothing wrong that you can put your finger on, and nothing particularly unpleasant happened, but you are left with the feeling of hollowness that is so disheartening and so distressing. It is almost as if people perform these days as if they are preparing recordings. They perform in a way that is intended to be very, very repeatable, with nothing out of the way, nothing vaguely eccentric or unusual, just inoffensive and standard, the same old tempos. And I think we've lost something, because in the past, judging from old recordings or live recordings, going right back to the oldest that we have, you know, turn of the century and early 20th century and all that, you feel that people would put everything into the heat of the moment, and they might do crazy things because it was not intended to be an artifact that people will play again and again and again. The way we have ended up performing has become rather inoffensive. And of course, one never wishes to offend anyone, naturally, but it's become much more neutral, much more standardized, and that's a very great pity.
And I wonder if I may show an example of that. I think of that freedom. There's a recording which I love very, very dearly. It's by the great composer and pianist Rachmaninoff, Sergei Rachmaninoff. He was maybe the greatest of all pianists. And there are quite a few of his recordings, and most of them are of little romantic pieces. There's not that much substantial music. And most of it is the sort of romantic 19th century stuff. But there is a wonderful recording of him playing a saraband from a Bach partita. Now, I wonder whether I could just, if I can negotiate the technicalities, if I could just play an excerpt of that.
I would be delighted, and I'm sure our listeners would be delighted also, please.
So let me see if I can get all this sorted out. No, that's not, it's this one. Okay, can everyone see the screen?
Yes.
So I'll start playing. Thank you. It is a miraculous thing, isn't it?
Wonderful. I would not change anything.
Yes, and the thing is, it seems to me that if you hear something like that, then firstly, it's completely free. You don't have the feeling that he's thinking about anything at all, except just it's flowing out directly. But equally, I know that if I live 500 years, I will never be able to play like that. It's so full of skill and artifice that I think it shows very well this kind of this contradiction between the freedom and the craft. There are so many changes of color, so many sudden changes of articulation. It's very, very difficult. If anyone plays the piano and tries to play like that, you will see it's impossible. You need to do it.
But what is so regrettable is that so few people would even try. So people would have this such an ideal. Because it is, of course, skill and artistry, but it's more than that. It is such intuitive and warm musicality, whereby instinctively, when there's a cadence and the phrase ends, it's shaded, it recedes, it goes into the background, and how a long phrase is spun out in a legato way, in a convincing way, and the agogics, how he knows just how little or how much to slow down in the right place and change the color and shade it. There's color and shade, and most people just bang away at the instrument as if it were a typewriter or an organ or something, believing that Bach should not be too expressive because the poor chap had harpsichords, but not pianos and so on and so forth.
But can I interject?
Credit to Rachmaninoff not only for the skill, marvelous skill, which he's wearing lightly and with which he's implementing his ideas, but the quality of his vision of the music.
Yes, but you see, I'm sort of averse to regarding that as a question of then and now. I'm very aware that pretty much any musician that I deeply admire has been dead for many, many years. So in reality, for me, it is probably a then and now situation. But, you know, Rachmaninoff was rare. When you say most people nowadays do this, well, most people nowadays did something very mediocre as well. It's Rachmaninoff that's special. It's that freedom. And it's true that it's possible that nowadays people wouldn't try to play in that kind of style. But I don't think it's a question of style. I think when I listen to that, I don't think of it as being romantic or being, whatever kind of style of playing. I just think of it, it's just how it is. And there's nothing, I don't think it's really subject to any kind of style. Of course, it is in a style, but in another way, the style doesn't matter. And this is an interesting point because, you know, when we speak about authenticity, this word authenticity, then there's a lot of, the word has been used for many years now to describe the proper way of playing something. In the days of Bach, it would have been done in such and such a way. We have many books in which it says that this is how we do it. And we have letters from Bach's son that says, this is how it should be done. And so if we want to play it properly, we have to do it like that. Now, I don't think, the problem with that always seems to me that I don't think that Bach is subject to style. And I don't think that Bach would have gone to a book to see, okay, how do we do it today, nowadays? Ah, yes, this is how we do it. Okay, so I will write it now. I don't think he did that. He wrote Bach. And Handel wrote Handel. And Telemann only wrote Telemann. And there's nothing that Telemann could do about it. He wasn't Bach. But I don't think that any book from 1685 or 1720 or 1760 will tell us the truth about how to perform Bach. I think it can give us inspiration. It can give us ideas. How about we try it at a higher pitch? How about we try it with fewer instruments? How about we try it without rubato or without vibrato? We can try all these things. They are interesting ideas, but they don't bring us any closer to the truth. Just like the way that Rachmaninoff is playing there, it doesn't matter what style he's playing. It's just what makes it special is what it is. There's nothing.
Yes, there's the nothing sheer musicality of it. The sheer musicality of it, which is something that transcends styles and transcends time. We came very close to those ideas in the previous sessions when we listened to a little bit of Monteverdi with Nadia Boulanger, Hugo Quena, and Paul de Rennes last week in connection with the Monteverdi Vespers of 1610, but also during our second session about the Bach Mass in B minor, when we heard Scherchen as well as Joshua Rifkin and Klemperer as well as others. And of course, as the late Hans Keller used to say, why ought we to reproduce conditions in which people thought of Vivaldi as a great composer and Bach as a great organist? in other words, yes, let us seek inspiration. It behoves us to seek out as much information as we can about historical circumstances. It is always better to know than not to know. But we need not limit ourselves. And also, we should be welcoming of a multiplicity of different ways of doing those things, because, to return to your very first point, these things are, as I like to look at them, these masterpieces are like diamonds, and you can look at those diamonds or shine light upon them from different angles, and each of those vantage points, each of those perspectives yields different beauties. Yeah, but yeah, it seems to me rather regrettable to confine ourselves and to deceive ourselves into thinking that one particular style of doing things is correct and everything else is old-fashioned, inappropriate, historically uninformed, and perhaps now there's light at the end of the tunnel, and I think that we're abandoning those fallacies for good. But in recent decades, certainly when I was an undergraduate, people would frown upon someone engaging in a bit of portamento when they were singing Bach, or Heifetz using glissando when he was playing a Mozart sonata.
Yes.
Not only is this a reality, but in fact, strictly musicologically speaking, they were actually wrong. Because if we make use of early recordings as a sort of telescope with which to look further back into the past, some of the very qualities that the so-called authentic performance people have been no longer advocating, but still manifesting in their performances, are really the very opposite of what we can hear in those early recordings, where there was much flexibility, spontaneity, glissandi as an extension of legato, a lot of agogic modifications that sound very, very natural, and a certain wholeheartedness, whereby one does not patronize the music, saying, oh gosh, I mustn't allow the praise to be longer than four bars, that would make it romantic, and we can't have that now, can we?
Yes.
But I think that what you're talking about goes well beyond this. I think that we've all grown out of those notions, and yes, the pursuit of truth to make the music come alive in the most beautiful and most moving and most convincing possible way is something that takes precedence over all these little considerations, although it does no harm for us to be musicologically informed, and it behoves us to try and find out as much as we can. But of course, often, I'm sure you will agree with me, when a manual by a contemporary, someone like Vance, would say that you ought not to do it like this, that doesn't mean that people would do it differently. It probably means that enough people were doing it in the way in which Quantz didn't like it, for Quantz to find it necessary to say, don't do it like this, yes, for example.
Of course. And in the end, it's to do with the meaning of your of the music, isn't it? And that truth, which is such a indefinable thing. And you know, don't you, how much I admire this old Dutch conductor Mengelberg. And yes. I think you suggested that I could show a little bit of his recording of the Matthew Passion. I admire him very much, but I wouldn't say that I'm crazy about all of his recordings. But for those listeners or viewers who are not so familiar with him, he was a Dutch conductor who took over the Concertgebouw Orchestra 1 year after it was founded, and conducted it for the next 50 years. And sadly, during the German occupation of Holland in the Second World War, he didn't cover himself with glory. I think he was particularly stupid in his dealings. He really collaborated more than, you know, one could really somehow understand. Or anyway, so after the war, he was not allowed to conduct anymore. But even before the war, in his conducting, he was famous for the liberties that he took. People said that he was the only conductor who could do a rubato with an orchestra. And he certainly did do that. He tried it an awful lot. He must have been very skillful with it, you know, with his baton technique, to make the orchestra follow him. Although I guess the orchestra would have known what to expect, and they probably would have given him a lot of they would have known what to expect from him. But this one recording of the Matthew Passion, he made it it's a live recording of a performance on Palm Sunday in 1939 in Amsterdam. So even that fills me with, you know, what is a concert like of a big tragic work of a tragic masterpiece of European music that's performed the last Palm Sunday before the most unbelievable hell breaks loose in Europe. It's just such, there's already so much meaning that one can take from the occasion.
Yes.
But my experience with this Matthew Passion was a little bit like you described with the Brahms symphonies. I had listened to it all my life before and thought it was, well, it was another piece by Bach. It's okay. Yeah, it's nice. And then I came across this recording and suddenly was so taken with everything. It just seemed as though, hang on, this is special. Something is happening here. Something terrible is happening. And I get so frustrated listening to the Matthew Passion or going to concerts and hearing the beginning played like a dance, like a little jolly minuet. It's a funeral march for the savior of mankind. And when you hear the recording of Mengelberg, you really do believe that something terrible is happening. And, you know, whether you like his style, whether you think it's a little bit overdramatic or Hollywood or whatever, there's no doubt what is happening here. And I think that is in itself something special.
Before you play it, allow me to quote you, because what you've just said has reminded me one of your splendid essays. In the journal Musical Opinion in 2008, you published an article called Prima la Musicologia, Bach Performance in Crisis. And if I may just quote a sentence or two from that before we listen to the Mengelberg. And ladies and gentlemen, you can go to Bella's website and click on the link to find the entire essay and much else besides. But I'm quoting what Bella published. Returning home from a recent performance in London of Bach's Passion According to St. Matthew, I was prompted to wonder whether I would ever again hear the opening chorus sung in the manner of a funeral ode, "Come, my daughters, help me lament," or whether I will be stuck with the lilting allegretto that I have come to expect, evoking an altogether more cheerful attitude to death than I can sympathize with. Personal preferences apart, it struck me how difficult it has become to experience the more expansive, lyrical, and expressive sides to Bach's music. A recitative that is given space to breathe, a cadence that seems meaningful, an aria or chorus that communicates the text, not just the musicology. I say, hear, hear. let's hear a little bit of the Mengelberg.
Thank you. I would like to play two excerpts, a little bit of the opening chorus, just where the chorus first comes in, just to hear the power. Mengelberg was not one who believed in one instrument or one voice to one part. He really had huge forces, and he uses them to give that kind of power. So I'll play a little bit of that, but then there's a passage later on. One of the things that that I learned from this recording is how a simple cadence can be unbelievably meaningful. The step from 5 to 1, it's just a musical commonplace, but it's the most terminal, it's a condemnation to death. It's everything. There's nothing further possible. It just says everything. There's no escape. It's terminal, it's finished. And when that happens in these pieces, there's just such depth. He really, you know, you could say he milks them, but he really finds substance in them. So the passage which I'd like to play a longer excerpt from is where Peter hears the crow for the third time and realizes that he has betrayed Jesus, just like Jesus told him. And as we know, he realizes his mistake or his weakness. And, you know, any of you who know the Matthew Passion vaguely know what kind of thing that sounds like. And I think you will be surprised how it can sound here. So those two excerpts, I will share my screen.
Thanks.
There we go. Now, this is the chorus. Just so that we don't spend too much time, but I would defy anyone to not understand that this is something tragic that's going on there, and that seems to me successful. Now here's this passage from the recitative. I'll play a little bit longer.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm fine. There seems to be some disturbance. Sorry to interrupt it like that. I'll stop sharing now. I don't know how you feel about that, but I just feel that it's full of unbelievable intensity, and that whatever one might have reservations about this or that aspect of it, it's as full of meaning as it could possibly get.
Yes, and let us not forget that he was also a great interpreter of Mahler. Oh, yes. With the same life and death quality, all embracing, you know, the stakes being high.
Yes.
Not just everyone wearing their wigs and being elegant and polite, but really everything.
And it seems to me that that is something that we are looking for, isn't it? When we listen to music, we want something to happen. And when I think about music nowadays, I feel that the notes that a composer writes, they are like a description, or like an instruction manual. But maybe a description is best. It is like Busoni once wrote, the composer looks into the ether and he sees something and he describes it with the notes at his disposal. It is a compromise. It has to be a compromise. It has to be a small reflection of what the reality is. In a platonic sense, there is an ideal there of this work. And the notes that we deal with are a description of it. And we have to use these notes to make that object that is being described a reality. And for me, these performances, they do that. Now, I don't have any difficulty in understanding that someone else might find that kind of truth somewhere else. But I think that is the point of it, isn't it? And it's not whether you are super conscientious about every little detail of Baroque tuning or how many instruments you have. That is Bach's business, how he had it. If I think how miserable he must have been, I mean, as far as I understand, he was very miserable with his situation, having to write for all these snotty school children. And if I imagine that now we are performing it with snotty school children because that's what he had, he must be so gutted.
Well, not all of us are, but point taken.
Yes, but maybe we should now think of the other side, because we've been talking about the meaning and about the spontaneity and the freedom, but maybe we should speak now also about how that is reflected in the detail of the score. You were quite interested in some aspect of phrasing that I had spoken to you once about in the Schubert. Do you remember? Well, this was one of his late piano pieces that I recorded some years ago and spent a lot of time. There were pieces that had accompanied me for many years. And so I played them in many different ways. But when I was to record them, then I had to think a lot about them, and you know, in a way you make a kind of decision, whereas before you can hedge your bets, and maybe that's what you were meaning before. One has to, the recording changes things, but in any case I gave it a lot of thought. And you know, it's funny because we have these scores which are very, the Urtext scores, which are very, very precise. You produced some Urtext scores yourself, haven't you? And I'm sure that you gave a lot of attention to each aspect of it. And I think when I use these scores, you know, when I was recording these Schubert pieces, I had, I don't know, 10 or 15 scores of these pieces, all different. You get a feel, you realize how much divergence there is. You think, you know, a normal uninitiated person thinks, well, you know, you play the Schubert piano piece, don't you? But in fact, there is no such thing as the Schubert piano piece. There is a manuscript that Schubert wrote. It wasn't finished. It's quite scruffy. And you don't really know what, you have to decide what all these signs mean. And then he made mistakes. And so you have to decide, well, this is obviously a mistake, but this could be a mistake. And this one, I don't know, it sounds a bit funny. Was it serious? I don't know. But on the other hand, it does look like what he's written. You have to decide all the time, don't you? And that's quite tricky. I'll just show you, very briefly, I'll share the screen and please show you one of these pages that I have here. Oh, yes, share. Where are we? Autograph here. Yes, so here we are. This is the autograph of this second piano piece. Now you can see that there's a lot of, in a way it's quite precise, but if you were trying to play this, you'd have to look quite carefully. There are things that are crossed out. There are things that are unclear. Now, when I recorded this, I used different editions and I used this manuscript copy to make certain decisions. And then when the CD was made and reviewed, one reviewer was he made the point that he suggested that I had followed an incorrect source and played something wrong, something that Schubert obviously didn't mean. And it all centers around this sign here. Can you see the cursor and what I'm referring to?
Yes, hairpins. Yes. Could it be that one of them is an accent?
Yes, so this is the nub of the problem, is that in Schubert, he was fond of writing quite long hairpins like this, that he then obviously in some cases used as an accent and some cases used as a diminuendo. So one doesn't know. So you have here a succession of chords. Now, the reviewer was of the opinion that this is an accent and that therefore this chord coming with a crescendo down here and a crescendo here is clearly a strong chord followed by, and this is actually a piano, followed by a soft response. Now, some editions and subsequently I myself believed that this is a crescendo to this chord and then a diminuendo, so that the main chord is this one and that this is already a little bit softer, followed by proper piano at this point. Now, I'm sure many people listening might think, oh, is it really, this is very, very small detail. Does it really matter? Well, it doesn't matter in the sense that if Rachmaninoff played it, I don't know what he would say of it, but the way that he played that Bach, we wouldn't assume that he was that fussed about all these little details. But at the same time, it all adds up to a kind of a view of the piece. Now, my view of this piece was that quite often he likes in this piece to lean to the second beat. It happens quite a few times. Now, I saw that as a general theme of this piece, that he likes to go to that second beat, that he writes on the second beat something which often asks to be emphasized. And therefore, it made sense that this chord here was a stronger chord, and this chord here was a weaker one, this one being on the second beat. And so, it fitted into my sort of general view of this. But it's all about this sign here. Now, I did find recordings. Shall I try to show you sort of acoustically what I had in mind? Would that be helpful?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Okay, so I'm going to try and find, hang on, now how do I get out of this? Sorry. I have here, I have to just leave this briefly, sorry.
Yes.
And then I can find it. No, it wasn't here. I'm so sorry. I will find it immediately. It
was whilst you look, let me just add that in the case of the Dvorak Mass in D, which... Yeah. I have been working on towards an edition recently published by Bernhardt, that if you compare earlier versions, such as the version with organ accompaniment alone or organ and lower strings, as opposed to the later orchestral version, I could quote one or two instances where Dvořák himself did one thing and then he did another. And it is actually in some ways quite analogous to this instance, that initially he treats the climax of the phrase as being somewhere slightly different, as evidenced by his dynamics and markings. Whereas in the orchestral version, it's different. In the orchestral version, he generally favors longer term build-ups and gradual resolutions. And one gets the impression that in the smaller scale version, at least smaller scale, I mean, the chorus may have been large, but in the sense of the accompaniment, just being organ or a smaller group, shorter range tensions and smaller peaks seem to be more to his taste. So conceivably, Schubert himself may have done it differently on one occasion and differently on another.
I would definitely imagine that. So this is my recording of that piece. It's near the beginning, so I'll just start it off. If I'm lucky, will it play? Yes, here we are. Sorry.
Perhaps we have to tolerate the advertisement in order that we can get to the...
Repeat. Let's do it again. So it's a very small thing, isn't it? I mean, I don't think I was making any big bang on that one, but there's definite falling away to that subsequent chord. So just as an example to compare, this is Brendel playing the same thing. Goes much more towards that the following chord. So I don't know, it's one can get completely wound up by these things. Can I could point out for your for the viewers, it might feel sort of pedantic, or it might feel sort of too focused on details, but as a musician, I'm sure you'll agree, one can get very paranoid about these things, because there is just, you think that there is like a way of playing it, that there's something that Schubert wrote, but in fact it's not like that. And one composer where this is particularly galling is, or interesting perhaps, is Chopin. Let me describe how Chopin wrote. You know, so if you want to just think this, you know, you want to play a Chopin mazurka, for instance.
But before you do so, Béla, if indeed this was the CD from which you played, it was the three Klavierstücke D946.
Yes, it was, yes.
Then allow me to say that as part of my preparation for this session, I actually noticed that notwithstanding what that critic may have drawn attention to, I think for this CD, the reviewer on the Fanfare magazine, no less, wrote, "Hartmann rises to the occasion very impressively, and I would rank his interpretation along with the best ones by Clifford Curzon, Alfred Brendel, and Sviatoslav Richter." They omitted to mention Rachmaninoff, because probably the critic had never had the chance of hearing Rachmaninoff play that. I mean, one can't get better company than that in the planet world. So I just took the liberty of quoting this. lest our listeners thought that the critics had torn you for pieces for not placing the accent there, but interpreting as a decrescendo. Actually, this CD was justifiably properly appreciated.
Thank you very much for pointing that out. That's very kind. Yes, so with Chopin, Chopin would, let's say Chopin sits down, he writes a mazurka. He spends a long time fiddling with all the possibilities and he finishes writing it. Chopin had terrible handwriting. So he gives it to his friend and says, please, could you make a nice clean copy of this? The friend makes a nice clean copy of it, presumably with one or two small mistakes. We are all human. And gives it back to Chopin, or Chopin says, oh, actually, could you give it straight to the publisher? They will publish it. So the friend brings it to the French publisher. The French publisher sets it, sets all the typeface and makes a proof, sends the proof back to Chopin. Chopin looks at it and says, oh yes, this is wrong. This is wrong. Actually, I prefer this piano to be a little bit later. Let's put it there. And so he makes a few corrections. Then the publisher takes the proof, then he prints the first edition, the first French edition. Again, some mistakes probably there, we are all human. And so you end up with a French first edition. Now, some months later, the German publisher and the English publisher say, we want that mazurka as well. So Chopin says, yes, here you are, here's the text. By the way, could you omit that repeat sign? And could you please put some accents over these chords? I always thought they needed a little bit more. So the French and the German and the English editions differ according to the French one. Then the French publisher says, hang on, you've changed some things. I want to have a second edition. And Chopin says, yes, yes. And by the way, I never liked the ending. Here's another ending. So the French second edition differs again. And then Chopin dies. Well, he died quite early, didn't he? He dies, and his pupils say, do you know, I know that this is, you know, this Chopin mazurka, but the maestro Chopin, he always said to me, here, you must get a little bit faster. And here, I like to do some, you know, play a little garland of extra notes. So this is why I play like that, because that's what Chopin really wanted. And, you know, then this pupil makes an addition showing all these extra things. And in 2020, we want to play that mazurka. What do we play? I mean, I'm not talking about like little problems with, you know, is this an accent or is this a diminuendo thing? They're completely different pieces. And so if you buy editions of Chopin pieces, you need to know which edition you're going to use. And, in, you know, it's funny because a lot of my pupils here play the Associated Board exams, the, you know, the music exams in the UK, and they always use the English first editions. And so it's really annoying because, you know, they will come and play a piece by Chopin and I'll say, no, it's wrong. What are you playing? What's this rubbish that you're playing? And then they show me, they're playing everything correctly, but it's the English edition. And nobody plays that because everyone plays the French edition. And they are real tangible differences. So the reason I'm going into all this is because I think, as you will say as well from your experience of making editions, when we are talking about the meaning or the truth or the authenticity, this is not in the notes themselves, because the notes are already very variable and they only reflect in a very loose way what the composer was after. And so I imagine if one on that basis tries to find the truth, one is on a wild goose chase. But nevertheless, you and I as musicians, we spend a lot of time, don't we? We dither about this, like I did about this accent. Is this, you know, is it an accent or am I supposed to get softer here? It's two different things. But you can get sucked into that, can't you? And then you lose sight of what actually matters. But it's a difficult, it's a conundrum as for a practicing musician, isn't it?
It is, but there are two different situations. One is when using your own taste and musicality, you decide that it has to be like this. It can't be like that. Maybe it even becomes a hobby horse, but you're determined that it should be like this. And there are instances where really the dilemma remains acute because it works both ways. And it is very difficult to choose between one or the other.
Very much so. Yeah, yeah. And I thank you very much for, you know, I'm complaining about the Bach interpretation, but I thank you very much for introducing me to Corboz, because he's a conductor so far away from Engelberg as one could not possibly get. But I find in him also truth. I find in him a wonderful, which just goes to show it's nothing to do with the style, is it? It's to do with your musicianship, your ability to see something in the something beyond the notes.
Yes,
but we, iconic object.
Nonetheless, we live in an age where there is a certain amount of snobbery towards certain approaches that have simply gone out of fashion.
Yes.
And I think that there will be a reaction against that. And we will see that it was partly a red herring. Not only a red herring. I mean, we have to be very grateful to the so-called authenticity or historically informed movement, because as well as a lot of really not particularly good stuff, it has helped unearth masterpieces that were unjustly neglected. And it has resulted in certain things that in the past, perhaps we were embarrassed by, certain dissonances that, a Monteverdi Madrigal where one tenor sings one note and then another one comes singing a semitone higher, and then immediately the first one backs off to avoid the dissonance. Whereas now we are more willing to make use of these vertical things. When we ornament when playing, say, Handel or Marc-Antoine Charpentier, if there's a sort of horizontal ornament and that horizontal ornament happens to be a sixth higher as well or a third lower, then we say, ah, so that forms a 6-4 chord that is nicely being resolved. So we give it more harmonic value. It's not just a horizontal thing. And so we make a point of putting a nice juicy appoggiatura on the upper auxiliary, which then resolves, and it's a chord that is resolving, not just something horizontal. So all these things we have learned from the early music movement.
Absolutely.
The early music movement has been also in some ways rather restrictive, rather snobbish, and in certain instances just plain wrong. I think that the evidence is, we know that Pierre Monteux played chamber music either with Brahms or certainly in the presence of Brahms. And because of his extraordinarily longevity, he conducted until 1964, I think, when he died, 64 or 63, something like that. So he had an extraordinarily long career. And if you compare some of the things he did with Brahms to the so-called authentic chaps, you will see that Monteux, who happened to be a much more musical person and a much better interpreter in general because of his warmth of musicality, does things very differently. So you are doubly wrong then in dismissing what Monteux is doing on the basis that Brahms, when he wrote his German Requiem, was apparently studying Schütz, and Schütz ought to be performed in a very critical and cold and inexpressive way. Ergo, Brahms should also be performed in a very...
Quite so.
You see how ridiculous it becomes. Or if we nowadays look at so-called authentic ways of doing Wagner that are four square and hardly any rubato and no glissandi, but then you listen to Richard Strauss in 1920 something or other with the Berlin Court Opera Orchestra, or whatever it was called, the State Opera Orchestra, antecedents of the Berlin Philharmonic. And Strauss was so restrained in performing his own music. He has different plateau of phrases, every phrase has its own tempo, and then particular motifs, when they end, he slows down, and there's the most sensual glissandi in the strings going up as well as going down. all the things that we are being told are old-fashioned, inappropriate, are in fact, strictly musicologically speaking, probably entirely appropriate. Not only is this authenticity business something of a red herring, although it behoves us to study the sources with diligence and with the best possible knowledge we can have of their context, but also sometimes so-called authenticity has, it seems to be, taken precedence over sheer musicality, and that's a very great pity. I think that it's disappearing now, fortunately, but I think there was a period of 2 or 3 decades when the idea was being inculcated amongst the public that if you want to perform a Mozart symphony, it ought to be a chamber orchestra, because you mustn't use a full symphony orchestra, forgetting that Mozart wrote a letter to his father, probably referring to the symphony number 34 in CK338, saying it was magnifique. They had a plethora of forces and, I don't know, 20 double basses and 40 violins or whatever. So some of this material, some of the convictions that have just been dominant in the musical public are just musicologically also very, very suspect, apart from anything else.
I have 2 observations here. One related to music. The first thing is, I always have the suspicion that in order to play music, we have to believe in the way that we're doing it. And the talk about, you know, this is how it should be, is just a kind of decision. Well, you know, if I'm going to believe in doing it this way, I can't do it just, well, you know, we might as well try this, but I have to believe that there's justification in doing it. Just like when Edwin Fischer, when he adds things, when he plays piano works by Bach and he adds things, he wasn't doing it randomly. He wasn't doing it sort of capriciously. He was doing it because he thought, and he says, he thought that this is the truth of the music. And so, in a way, the authenticity movement is doing something similar. And they are just, maybe we shouldn't be taken in by the words quite so much. Maybe it's we just don't worry about what they say, but we just worry about, you know, whether we like what they're doing with it. Related to that, I also have always the suspicion that the first half of the century was full of such great musical performers, such consummate artists and characters, personalities. If I think of myself in 1960, what can I do? If I want to play a Brahms symphony and I don't happen to be Giulini, there's not really that much I can do. 1960, maybe you can get away with it. But in 1980, it feels like everything has been done. Am I going to be compared endlessly to Klemperer or to Furtwängler, you know, to Casals, to Horowitz, to Rubinstein? How does one escape that? How does one renew it? In a way, the only way of doing it is by just completely resetting stuff, saying, okay, that's them. Now we start again. We have new criteria. We start again. And then we're not going to be comparing ourselves to the past anymore. So maybe this whole temporary, as you say, it's calming down a bit now, but the temporary tyranny of this performance practice, this informed practice, is just an attempt to wipe the slate clean and to allow a new new set of parameters, of criteria to become established so that we can explore completely different aspects of it. Obviously, we lose a lot of stuff doing that, but maybe it's just a reaction to that. Do you see what I mean?
Yes, I do. And of course, it has enriched us. I'm not against. First, I think that it behoves us as performers to gather and critically appraise knowledge that is available. It is inexcusable not to avail ourselves of information that is available. But information is not a substitute for musical talent or musical conviction. And the fact that I know that when something was first performed, it happened in such and such a way in some respects, or that people may have expected this or that and the other, need not, in my view, necessarily limit me to attempting slavishly to reproduce their circumstances. Yes. Indeed, there is an element of hypocrisy, or not hypocrisy perhaps, but a lack of genuine wholeheartedness in doing that, because when we perform Bach, it is difficult to forget, to wipe out of our memories the fact that we've also performed Stravinsky and Schoenberg and Debussy.
Yes.
And paradoxically, if we try to pretend that we haven't heard Brahms when we perform Bach, we won't be able to perform Bach as Bach was performed in his own day, because people who played Bach were not trying to put on silk gloves and to limit themselves and to prevent themselves from doing it in a stylistically inappropriate way, or being cautious about preventing themselves from being too romantic, etc. I mean, music is romantic art, if the word has any meaning, and so how can you perform it in a way that limits yourself and unduly restraining oneself? Yes, I'm not saying that you should do things that are really, that do not help the music, but in answer to your question, it was also something that was driven, I think, by the recording industry, because the mainstream repertoire had been largely recorded, and they even started recording things still on LPs, but which were digitally recorded, and that meant that they could avoid distortion, etc., etc., and they ran out of steam, and in order to sell things so that the recording industry would survive, the new innovation was exploited, which was the advent of compact discs. So a lot of music lovers already had some recordings that they were very, very fond of, were delighted, such as myself, were delighted to avail themselves of CDs of the same recordings, because then you no longer had the feeling that every time you're playing an LP, it's being worn out. And the next time you play, there's going to be a bit more of a crackle. And if you're unlucky, you know, the tone arm may jump a little and you may lose a little bit, or it may get stuck and repeat the same thing again and again. Actually, perhaps we should miss that, because every time we listen to music, there was the feeling that you're expanding a limited resource. And that meant we used to listen with much greater avidity and much greater attention. Whereas now, you know that if you're playing something on a CD or you're streaming it from somewhere, you could play it any number of times and the quality of it would decline. Anyway, so CDs emerged. And then a lot of people replaced their collections using CDs. And again, the record industry had run out of steam. So up to a point, maybe, it was a marketing tool to say that there's going to be a new recording of the Brahms German Requiem with Donnell Gardiner and everyone else before, the poor chaps. They were misguided. They didn't know what we now know. And this is going to be it.
Yes, I agree.
That's a publicity gimmick. I don't blame the performers for it, but of course, the record industry wants to survive so that it can make more and more recordings, often very fine recordings. And of course, they are not charities, they seek to make a profit. But conceivably, musicologists who were themselves not motivated by this, but they were genuinely feeling that they were onto something, as indeed in many cases they were, and a lot of new knowledge has been gained. Much of it is fascinating and extremely interesting and illuminating. But it's no substitute for subjective insight and illuminating a work with an interpretation that is, in the best case, worthwhile, moving, enlightening, something that truly helps serve the composer and communicate what the composer was doing as convincingly and beautifully as possible to the audience. And that is something really, it's a je ne sais quoi that is less easily tangible. I like to use the word musicality, which I use in a way that is distinct from the word musicianship. Musicianship is to do with technique, it's to do with things that are developed and acquired, it comes from hard work and training. But musicality is the spark that it seems that some great interpreters have to a far greater extent than certain people who have achieved distinction by virtue of technique and being able to play something faster than anyone else, or I don't know. Sometimes I get the impression that we have been carried away by a tendency to look at music as a kind of competitive sport. Who can run the fastest or the greatest distance? And I think that that has absolutely nothing to do with musicality. And by the same token, I'd argue that orchestral virtuosity, though it's something that I welcome and I do try to cultivate it up to a point, but it's not the whole point. And sometimes you find that something that is more rugged and perhaps not perfectly together and not polished, and it may even be a little bit out of tune in places, can actually do more for you as a moving musical performance than something that is flawless, but cold and inhuman. I'm not saying that being technically polished is a bad thing, or that being technically polished necessarily results in something being less musical. I mean, I'm all for the polish. We don't want to be distracted by unpleasant mistakes and something being out of tune or not together. But we ought to be able to transcend these things.
Can I put something in for discussion, which might be provocative and take us in different direction? But it, I've often wondered, well, I'll digress very briefly. When we walk here in the neighborhood, I live in a beautiful area where there's wonderful landscape. Much of it belonging to this thing called the National Trust, this organization that looks after a nice landscape in a non-agricultural way. One of our favorite places is regularly destroyed. So there are many bulldozers that come, tear out the trees, burn them. The place looks like a war zone. This is done because there is heather. There are certain plants which used to grow there. And if the trees get too big, then the heather can't survive and it changes. It becomes a forest. It stops being a heathland. Now, this happens quite a lot throughout the UK. Landscapes are managed in order to keep them as they were. I'm not sure at what point they were like that. I'm sure if you go back a little bit further, they were different. But you know, at some point, they were like that. And this is what we want to achieve. I find that a very curious logic. I can sort of see it. It's nice to have heathland. Yes, you like to have heather. You've got enough forests. You want to have some heathland. That's fine. You do it. But the logic of doing it, because that's how it used to be, that seems strange to me. Now, it seems very relevant to me to our conversation, because it's the same thing, isn't it? We have the question, do we want to, we play it as it used to be, as it used to be performed, as it is properly, this is how it was. The fact that we don't really know how it was, and the fact that it doesn't really matter how it was, is beside the point. It used to be like that, so that's what we have to do, in spite of the fact that it's from a sort of intellectual point of view, completely absurd proposition. And it's really just a question of how do we want it to be? So if I want to listen to a piece by Bach, how do I want it to be? I like it to be fast and transparent and rhythmical and unfussy. Fine, so that's how I can do it. But I can also want it to be expressive, expansive, full of meaning. I can want that too. But it's not a question of how it used to be, it's a question of, well, that's how I could, how I would like it. Now, this is where the, maybe the provocative part of it comes. In many European countries, there is a problem with immigration. It's not, the way that England is now is not how it used to be. It used to be that everyone here was English and that we did things in a certain way. It used to be that America was in a certain way and it was great, yes? All countries have this thing. It used to be like that, and this is what we want, yes? Now, I wonder whether there is some link in these things, this desire to recreate something from the past, that it always implies, doesn't it? It's not a question of this is just how it used to be. It's always also implied it was better that way. So, you know, if we find a journal, a musicological research that shows that, in fact, Beethoven used to conduct this passage with four horns and not two, it's always better that way. Yeah, they never ever say, but in fact, it sounds nicer with four. They always will say, ah, he only did it with two. Ah, marvelous. It sounds so amazing, yes? So the implication is not just that this is a historical thing, but also that it is an improvement, that this is how it's better. Just like the heathland where I go for a walk, it's not that it used to be full of heather, because we, after all, we don't really know about that, but it's better that way. It shouldn't be forest. And England, as it was 50 years ago, it's not just that there were fewer foreigners there, but it's better that way, you know. That's always the implication, isn't it? And I am convinced that there is a link between these things.
You're probably right, and you're not the only one who says it. There was something by Richard Taraskin, I think, about authenticity.
Yeah. Marvelous.
Quoted by my friend Alexander Lingas in connection with the Byzantine musical tradition. And Taraskin's argument is more or less like this, that in seeking authenticity and going back to a certain ideal in the past, as you say, something that is deemed to have been better and purer and more authentic and closer to an ideal that became corrupted, there's this idea that it's like restoring a magnificent old painting. Centuries of dirt,
yes,
have accumulated on the surface, and all you need to do is to clean it and take away that dirt, and then it will shine in its glory. But of course, in saying that an organic musical tradition of centuries standing with a lot of very great interpreters contributing to it, you're saying that all these people are dirt, that anything and yes, anyone between the time of Monteverdi or of Bach or of Brahms and ourselves is undesirable, objectionable, yes, undesirable and objectionable, and has to be removed, and we can return to the celestial original. There's a letter written by the Armenian monk Archimandrite Komitas, who was a genius as a musician, but nonetheless, he had some ideas that were very much in the air at the time, who was educated in Berlin at the end of the, during the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries, where there was a lot of nationalism in music. And he wanted to decipher the Armenian medieval neumes, which have still not been deciphered. So that means that there are a lot of ecclesiastical melodies which have reached us via various notational systems, oral tradition, a sort of organic tradition with certain losses of continuity, no doubt, but we cannot reconstruct what these items would have sounded like in medieval times. And also, there are a lot of items that are condemned to being mute because we don't have any melodies for them other than the ones encoded in those neumes that we cannot read. But in asking the head of the church to help him get hold of a manuscript that he was convinced would help him decipher the neumes, he said, if I manage to decipher the neumes, then we shall finally be able to hear those hymns in their celestial purity. Implying that this ideal of celestial purity, when these items were first composed, was lost. It became corrupted through the centuries. And he wishes to go back to this ideal archetype, a little bit like a Platonic archetype, as you say. And though he did a lot of wonderful things, I do think that this idea is illusory. And you know, I'd dearly love to hear what these melodies were like in the 12th century, not because they would be better and more celestial and purer, but out of sheer curiosity. But it is quite possible that if we heard those melodies as they sounded in the 12th century, we wouldn't even like them. That's not to say that one is any less curious and eager to see what work we can do to decipher these early notational systems. But it is the same phenomenon. It's a penchant that people have in trying to go back and recover something that we feel that we have lost. And of course, in going backwards, we inevitably discover things that are new, and that is not a bad thing. On the contrary, anything that enriches us is a good thing. I think it would be going too far to say that there is something maybe neo-fascistic about seeking this illusive authenticity in music. And I'm sure that is not what you are saying, but certainly I think that allowing a certain breadth to the tradition and the multiplicity of different stylistic approaches is something that can enrich us all. And we should not be doctrinaire about what we consider to be admissible and what we consider not to be admissible. In that sense, again, I remember we did analysis at the Dartington Summer School of Music, which I went to as a youth, with Hans Keller and Peter Max Davis. And one of the things was the Mozart Sonata for violin and piano in B flat major, is it K440 or 450, something like that. And it was this beautiful recording with Heifetz. I can't remember who the pianist was, but it was beautiful piano playing as well. And we were transfixed and we were listening, scores in hand, and then suddenly Heifetz made a slide, a glissando, and you could hear people sniggering or making all sorts of noises, even hissing. Ah, he didn't know any better. And Hans Keller immediately stopped the recording and said, "What's your objection?" I think that we should appreciate beautiful interpretations, including beautiful interpretations of the sort that involved great composers editing the music of other great composers, or great interpreters editing the music of great composers. There is much to learn from them. There is much that can enrich us. And yes, from time to time, one may wish to reset, to clear one's bookshelves, so to speak, metaphorically, and see, let's try and forget what we have learned and just try and start with a clean slate. I think it was Sir Georg Scholti who, each time he would conduct a symphony, he would insist on using a brand new score so that he would not be influenced by his earlier markings. But we cannot erase our memories, and we cannot pretend when we perform something that we haven't heard other music in the meantime. And there would be something disingenuous and something highly non-authentic about trying to perform Bach in a way that denies our more recent musical experiences, I think. So that's my reaction to what you say.
Yes, no, I understand. I think it's the answer is not very exciting, is it? The answer is that we should be more tolerant to change and accept that there are many different types of beauty, many different perceptions of beauty, and that our job as a musician is not to follow a law, or the only law that we should follow is the quest to communicate the thing that we honestly find behind, hidden behind the notes.
Yes, but this is not a license for not trying as hard as possible to get the best, most reliable text that we can, and availing ourselves of what musicology has to offer. Mm. But that, in my view, is merely a starting point. That is not an end in itself. And also, plurality is desirable. I myself remember, as a 15-year-old, 16-year-old, I would have a kind of musical schizophrenic tendency. I would listen to the Bach Mass in B minor as I'd pirate recorded it off the air from a broadcast of the Kyrie and the Gloria from the Proms with Andrew Parrott and the Taverner players and singers. So I would crave to hear once again so-called authentic Bach dancing away, and then immediately, like a child who has eaten something that is excessively sweet and wants to eat something savory and salty to counteract it, I would then run and place an LP on the turntable and listen to Klemperer's Bach Mass in B minor. And when I'd had enough of that, I would feel, but I need to clean the system, I need to flush it out, and I'd go back, I'd alternate from one to the other. But when it came to the crux, I remember having a very heavy cold or flu or whatever, lying in bed, thinking rather morbidly, at my funeral, whom would I wish to hear? The dancing Bach or the profound and searching and, you know, spiritually far more penetrating Klemper? The answer is obvious. Now, I'm not saying that at any moment our mood is such that we wish to perform music or hear music as if it were at one's own funeral or some moment of such very extreme gravity. All these things have their place, but one should seek, it is all the pursuit of meaning, whatever that means, and please forget circularity in this sentence, and the cultivation and nurturing of musicality. And that too, I'd be hard-pressed if you push me in a corner and ask me to define that. But it is something that I have very much sensed in your own performances, I have to say, which is why in having our little conversation for the benefit of our friends who are listening and might do so in future weeks via YouTube, I've always felt that there is a lot of common ground, but then the things that we're trying to define or understand by their very nature can only be you can only go so far, but from that point onwards, you have to take certain things on trust that are ineffable and not really amenable to cut and dried definition. What do you say?
I say that you have to let the music speak for itself. And on that note, because I know that we are sort of drawing to a close, aren't we? I wonder whether we could just hear that little vocal excerpt that includes your favorite French singer, because it seems a very nice way of showing what the only thing that matters about it all. Shall I
show you? Are you sure he's French and not Swiss?
Ah, I mean your favorite.
You mean Swiss. Monsieur Hugues Quenot?
Yes,
Swiss, not French.
Sorry.
My favorite French singer would be Pierre Bernac, I would say.
Ah, yes, okay, I understand. Shall I do that?
Please.
Okay, so here we are. This is, for the benefit of everyone else, this is a waltz by Brahms that scored for two pianists at one piano, so piano four hands and four singers. And it's a cycle called Liebeslieder waltzes, because the text, the poems are all various types of love songs. And this is a particularly beautiful one. And it is played by the young Dino Lupati. Well, he was particularly young at this point. And his teacher of the time, Nadia Boulanger, with a quartet of singers whom I don't remember actually, but I just remember that Haig's favorite Swiss singer, Hugues Quenon, was there. So it's just a brief waltz. Let me play it to you. Beautiful, yes?
Yes. Thank you so much, Béla. And I think that we've got a couple of minutes in which I can invite, if there's anyone who would like to ask anything.
Wonderful.
Whilst we still have the benefit of Béla being with us. I know a lot of interesting thoughts have been thrown about, a lot of stimulating ideas for us to mull over and ponder on. Anyone would like to ask any questions?
I would. Hi.
Tom, please.
And good evening to you.
Good evening.
A very good evening.
Well, first of all, thank you for such a wonderfully rich discussion. Let me focus on one thing. Béla, you mentioned Zen and the Art of Archery. Mm-hmm. As I recall, the master's response to that question of drawing the bow was, don't draw the bow, allow the bow to draw you.
Right.
Do you recall that?
It sounds familiar. It's a very long time. So I think I've lived with a recollection more than with a book. So
For me too. But I think the point of it was in metaphorically is that it's a question of being in submission to the music rather than mastering the music.
I see what you mean. Yes, but I guess in submission to the music, I would agree that we always have to be in submission to the music. But I guess where do you search for the music? Do you search for it in the details of the text, or do you search for it in the meaning that it's trying to convey to you? So. I completely agree. We must approach the music in a spirit of humility and adventure, and it's the music that will guide us. So yes, I think that's a very important point.
Right, and then that touches on what Haig was saying before about musicianship versus musicality. You're touching on, and that statement really hit me, looking at music as a competitive sport. Being in the United States, I see that all the time. I see, marching band competitions as opposed to, presenting concerts and and that sort of thing. And it also reminds me of, Vladimir Horowitz had in the 1970s, I remember him bemoaning the proliferation of all of these piano competitions and churning out all of these technicians as interpreters, you know, as opposed to people like himself who, yes, might make, good heavens, might make a mistake every now and again, but, you know, were brilliant. He was a brilliant interpreter.
Definitely, yes.
You know, so all of this really has this touches home for me, and I want to thank you both for a very lively discussion.
Thanks, thank you Tom. Very much. But I'd like to say one thing. It's not so much musicianship versus musicality in the sense that there's nothing more boring than to go to a concert where there's someone with a brilliant technique, but nothing else. But there's nothing sadder than to encounter a musician or a singer with musicality, but not the necessary technique to allow them to realize that musical vision. So mastery is desirable, including technical mastery, but must not become an end in itself. And mastery does not consist merely of technical excellence, but those other less tangible things that mean that when certain musicians see a score, and when Béla, for example, looks at the Schubert manuscript, often he feels that, yes, this is how it should be, and this is how it works.
In response to that, can I just relate a very interesting little thing? I had pleasure of chatting to Murray Pariah some time ago about his years. He studied with Horowitz. I asked him, what was it like studying with Horowitz? What did he teach you? And Pariah said, the most important thing that he taught me was that if you want to be more than just a technician, you have to be a technician first. So you do actually, it's all very well to want to be more, but you do have to achieve the means to be able to create more. And I think that's also what Francis Bacon the painter was saying, is that it takes a lot of work to be able to play something very simple and spontaneous. The two are, they go hand in hand, don't they?
But the thing is, at competitions, it is much more easy to measure technical excellence.
Yes, but I mean,
Elusive intangible things. And our present competition culture has resulted in technique acquiring perhaps excessive prominence. And that may also have to do with the recording, not the recording industry, but the prevalence of recordings. Most of us are more likely to get to know a piece by having heard a recording of it first rather than at the concert hall. And recordings are designed to be devoid of annoying things such as mundane, banal mistakes and wrong notes. And therefore, we expect that anyone who ever performs anything in public should do so in a way that is flawless. And so you see that already the expectations skew the product that one gets, which is a shame.
Yes. Any other questions, you think?
Well, I have one.
Oh, yes.
But it is of a very, very banal nature. How are you dealing with lockdown and the pandemic-related limitations that confront us all these days?
Well, I feel guilty in saying that as far as life in general is concerned, then it has been a very happy time, because I think that maybe, you know, particularly as a musician, but I guess in many fields, life is very hectic and one is rushing around here, there, and trying to do everything that is possible. And if everything that is possible is very limited, then one does far fewer things and one does have an opportunity to enjoy those things that one does more, maybe. Yes? So, I mean, I definitely will remember 2020 very fondly, even if with, important caveats. However, as an actual, as a practicing musician, it's a different matter. Most of my time goes on teaching and on, spending time with the family and looking after my daughter. But concerts, it's very tricky, isn't it? I mean, what I find really striking and pleasing in this country, in Britain, is that at the forefront of re-emerging concerts are the small clubs. You know, I had a concert last week for a little club in Brighton. There are a few people who run it. It's a, it's not a lucrative thing. You can't make a living playing in places like that. But everyone who came to that concert really wanted to go. They were really happy to be there. And I was really happy to be there because I hadn't played a concert in quite a long time. And so many people wanted to come that they had to be turned away because they were, there's a limit to how many people could come in. But it was a quick organization in a simple church with a simple piano, nothing special, but it's flexible. And you feel that it's just in the service of people who want to come and hear some music. I want to come and play some music. It's wonderful. There's no industry. There's nothing else besides. So, I would like to have played all the concerts that I had planned for this autumn, but the two concerts which I've played so far since February or since March have both been very valuable ones for me, and I will remember them very warmly as well. I think it's a difficult time, but there is, as always, a lot that one can take, a lot of valuable experience that one can take from these moments.
Well, it is a very great pleasure wholeheartedly to thank Béla for everything that he has said today, not least these last few inspiring thoughts, indicating that even in those circumstances we can find positive things. And that's, after all, what we've been trying to do with the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra as well, by dint of having these weekly online motivation sessions on repertoire and interpretation. Just to remind everyone that a week from now, we shall have the last such session this semester, and it will be devoted to the conductor and composer, Otto Klemperer, who is one of my favorite conductors. So, ladies and gentlemen, don't miss that if you are able to come. And tomorrow afternoon at 6 p.m. Prague time, there will be an hour's program for the Charles University Alumni Club devoted to Christmas music and thoughts about Christmas music with the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra, where I've been invited to present some recordings of Christmas carols and the Reba Christmas Mass brief excerpts, together with various memories of previous years of performing, because the Christmas period used to be an extremely busy one with concerts, particularly in Prague, where there's a tradition of Christmas performances, especially of the Reba Pastoral Mass, perhaps in some ways comparable to the popularity of Handel's Messiah in the English-speaking world at Christmas time and Easter. So that's 6 p.m. and anyone who wishes to attend can do so by dint of registering on the pages of the Charles University Rector's office. There's it's called the UK Plus Point or something like that. So you can see also the link on my Facebook pages if you English. So I hope that you will be able to attend one or both of these as well. Once again, very many thanks to Béla for this splendid session, inspiring and enjoyable in equal measure. And I hope, ladies and gentlemen, that you will be well. And thank you all for attending, because of course, although probably more people will watch this afterwards via YouTube, nonetheless, seeing that there are people avidly following and listening is very encouraging and inspires us to go on and share further thoughts and further musical examples, as Béla has done so splendidly this evening. Thank you very much indeed, and I bid you all a very good evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maestros. This was amazing. Thank you.
Thank you, Tomás. Thank you. Thank you so much.